to be loved by you. Though my brokenness has seen some days, your mercy's still brand new.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning to all of you watching us from home as well. Really glad to see all of you in the house of the Lord this morning. Some of the announcements that we have, you will notice that you will not see Captain Claudia today. She is on her way to take Isabella, Roger, and Erica. There will be boarding to go to Territorial Music Institute that's taking place. It's a music camp, if you're not familiar with all the acronyms. It's a music camp. It's a territorial music camp that's taking place at Camp Hublitzell. It's in Texas. So they're on their way right now to Tampa to catch a plane. And we're really excited about what the Lord's going to do during their time at Camp Hublitzell. We also just came back yesterday from camp. We had Isabella, Juliana, Quincy, Elias. I'm forgetting one. Who am I forgetting? And Josiah. Yes, they spent a week there for FMI. That's a different acronym right there. But it's basically is a Florida Music Institute that took place at camp, in our camp here in Florida. And they had a great time. We came back in a way visiting with them, and the experiences they had were priceless. So thank you all of you that have been praying for our kids, been praying for our leaders. They're driving those kids back and forth. And as well as for the camp staff, we really appreciate it. It has been a great camp season. Just the fact that we're able to go back, it's already a blessing. So you see some of our normal announcements there. A few things to highlight there. August 3rd, shop your way. We have a to-go lunch. If you need more information, please reach out to my wife or Miss Lisa. And you see there for the teens and the young adults, we're going to go zip line outing August 7th. Pray for us. If we survive, we'll be back. We have good insurance, I hope. I'm just kidding. So this is the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in Him. Amen. Again, really glad to see each one of you. And with that, we're going to ask Ms. Leola to come here and lead us in a call to worship. And in the meantime, I'll ask the praise band to start making their way to the stage. We'll be next with the two songs.
Call to worship. I'll be leading and you all will follow. Can you hear me? For God alone, our soul wait in silence, for our hope is in Him.
He alone is our rock and our salvation.
Shall we shake Him? Our God leads our deliverance and our honor. His praise in our God. Trust in Him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us. Let us worship the one to whom belongs power and steadfast love. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ms. Leola. So, you know, as we continue in our Honest Prayer series, I hope you are carrying your prayer journal around. I hope you are able to, you know, write down some prayers, see already God moving in your life. And part of what we're going to be looking into today, it's our necessity of God. Because, you know, it's one thing is for us to say, oh Lord, I need you, and just to think in our mind. But another thing is for us to exercise that. So, you know, most of the songs today in worship and later on with the sermon will be on this idea of honestly seeking for God, because He's our Redeemer, He is our Sustainer, He is our God. Amen. So I invite you to stand and worship with us today as we say, Lord, we need you. I need you. We need you.
Find my rest in Thank you. to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
Amen. Amen.
Our dear precious Heavenly Father, today we come before you at this altar to praise you, to let you know that we know you are worthy. And Father, please help us to get something out of our service today. Please help us all in our own way to surrender all to you. And Lord, if someone's here today that feels like they want to join the Holy Family, and they want to become a Christian, and they haven't, we pray that you will touch their hearts and lead them to this altar of prayer. And we know, Jesus, that you did it publicly. You were baptized by your cousin, John the Baptist. And you said, if you give your heart, if you give your life, do it publicly so others will see your light shine. If someone feels those strings of love tugging them today, please lead them to the cross. Please lead them to the altar. We ask that you forgive us of our sins. We know we aren't worthy. We thank you so much for your grace that you always forgive. We ask that you keep our children on the way to Texas safe, that you keep our Captain Claudia safe coming back to us. We thank you for Salvation Army and people who lead and people who serve to make our world a better place. And Lord, most of all, we know we're here today for some purpose. You led us here someday, today for some purpose. Please help us to know what it is. We love you, Jesus. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated.
Sorry about that, I didn't know I was next. Okay. We believe that the continuance in the state of salvation depend upon continued obedience, faith in Christ. God bless this reading.
Good morning. We are going to be reading from Psalm 51. If you have your Bible, follow, or it should be on the screen. But also, I have journaled in the past, not just now, on Psalm 51, and the Lord speaks a lot through this psalm. So like Captain Challenge, you make sure you have your journal and your writing. But for me, I love to Bible journal, and as you can see, my Psalm 51 is all decorated. It's, you know, the Lord, we are challenged to repent of our sins and go before the Lord and just give it all to him like we just sung. Surrender it all over to him. And one of my notes here says, you know, Lisa, I'm asking you to search every corner of your life. And I want for you to find those areas where you're weak, and I want for you to bring them to me. And I, your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, will cleanse you and make you whole. So the same David recognizes that he sinned, and he goes to the Father and the Lord forgives them, right? Because the blood of Jesus washes us, and the blood of Jesus gives us a new heart. So let God, who is so full of mercy, and He loves you so much, He will forgive you and just love on you. So let's go into the Word. Have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love, because of your great compassion. Blot out the stain of my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin, for I recognize my rebellion. It haunts me day and night. Against you and you alone have I sinned. I have done what is evil in your sight. You will be proved right in what you say, and your judgment against me is just. For I was born a sinner. Yes, from the moment my mother conceived me, but you desire honesty from the womb. Teach in me wisdom even there. Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy. You have broken me. Now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sins. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit away from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and make me willing to obey you. Then I will teach your ways to rebels, and they will return to you. Forgive me for shedding blood, O God, who saves. Then I will joyfully sing of your forgiveness. Unseal my lips, O Lord, that my mouth may praise you. And I pray that our prayers, your hearts are ready to receive what the Lord has for you. And may God have mercy on all of us. Amen.
Yeah, I'm on. Good morning again. Book of Psalms is one of the books that I really enjoy reading. And only like as I grew up as a Christian, not like in my life, but grew up as an individual Christian that understood more about Scripture. That's when I understood that's a collection of poetry. And it, to me, is just so intriguing that many, many of us, sometimes we read the Psalms and we don't even know that's poetry. And Israel wrote a lot of poetry throughout history. Kings, prophets, they all wrote poems. And some poems were sung in the temple, some poems were used during family time at home. And the Book of Psalms is a collection of those strategically placed in order to tell a biblical story. You see, and the Book of Psalms offers several ways to rejoice in prayer, to bow in worship, to exalt God for all that He does, all His blessings. And as you know, this is a collection of 150 poems that we put all together. And we can divide this book in basically three parts. One, the first part will be the story of King David and the royal family. The second section will be the downfall of David and the exile of Israel. And the third part will be a restored kingdom at the other side of the exile. So today we're going to be looking at the first part, and that was the passage that Miss Lisa read for us. You see, King David he went through a lot of hardships, but he did trust in the Lord. He had faith on the Lord. And in the first part of the Psalms, we see that David, he fears
this idea of punishment. So he faced his fears and he confesses that he made a mistake. And that he needs God's forgiveness. And then we see down through the passage that Lisa read that at the end he thanks God because he knows that God is his redeemer. So today we're going to explore this idea of repentance and needing the Lord. Because I don't know if it's this ever happens to you, but sometimes when things are going really well, we tend to forget a little bit about God. But when things are not going so well, where do we go? To the Lord. Many years ago, somebody asked me a question, and I thought it was a great question. And I want to share with you if you never heard. This concept of let's just pretend for a moment your life was perfect. There's no problems whatsoever. You know, picture wherever means perfect in your own life. There's no sin. There's no lack of money. There is no lack of resources. It's a perfect life. There's no sickness. There's nothing. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. It's a perfect life. Would you need God in your life? You know, and I remember that when somebody asked me that, it took me a second to think, like, okay, would I need God? I mean, the real answer is, yes, we should. But I think humans tend to go to the Lord in times of trouble. And there's nothing wrong with that. But we also have to exercise this need that we have for the Lord when things are going well. Amen? But one of the hardest things that humans struggle is to go to God in repentance. You see, God is not ashamed of us. God is not ashamed of ourselves when we have sinned against Him. You see, sin brings shame, but the gospel of God, the gospel of Jesus, brings joy. They're two different things. Prayers of repentance are not ways that we can make God loves us more. God already loved us to the infinity and beyond. When we go to Him, we go to Him because we're trying to experience His grace even more, even in a deeper level. Repentance basically brings us close to God and helps us to experience His unfailing love. And Psalms 51 is one of the most revealing one of the most revealing poems that they've ever composed. You know, and if you look at the history and if you want to read this later, he's writing this psalm because he's repented for his sin in 2 Samuel 11 when he sinned against Bathsheba and her husband. And the basic story is that he put her husband in the front of the battle, so he could die, because he had a relation with his wife. They want to hide the whole story. It's very, very sad but interesting story. 2 Samuel 11, if you want to read when you go home. So David's come here and he's repenting because he knows that he committed a sin. Verses 1 and 2, David begins by begging the Lord, "Please, Lord, have mercy on me." He speaks about this removal of guilty and sin, like the removal of dirt and stains from laundry. Stains are annoying. I don't know about you, but I find stains to be really annoying. Last week I went to the outlets and we brought Roger with us because Roger said, "I've never been to an outlet mall." So I'm so glad that we get Roger's being exposed to new things, like an outlet. So we went to the outlet mall, and I remember that I had this T-shirt that I never wore before. And I was like, okay, that's a good T-shirt. And I put some shorts, and I put a tennis shoe. I was like, I never wore this shirt before. Make me look young, you know. So I went with that T-shirt. And I remember that as we went on, and I ate something, and then it's just that drip of food just came in my shirt. I don't know about you, but it's annoying. And then if you just leave it there, it gets hard and it becomes a crust. But if you lick your finger and you try to get up, then you got to smear. which is most times makes even worse. So I went to a restroom and I put some water and I scrubbed it. And then what happened is it's a light blue shirt. Well, now I have this strip of diarrhea poop brown coming down the shirt. And I could not remove that. But you see, when we go to the Lord with our sins, the Lord is not just, He's removing completely. Completely. We are the ones that many times we have a hard time believing that. But He's removing. He's saying to you, no, I'm not, don't be ashamed. You can come to me. And David makes a powerful statement in verse 4 because he says, against you, only you, he's talking to the Lord, have I sinned. You see, David is even concerned beyond the people that he actually, that the sins actually had an effect on. He's going beyond, I sinned to the Lord. That makes me ask, why? Why he's not mentioning anything about Bathsheba and her husband? Because I think David understands that when we sin against each other, we ultimately sin against God. And if our goal is to ultimately love God, as a consequence, we're going to love each other. And then on verse 10, David asks the Lord to clean his heart and make all new. All new. That shirt that had the stain, it was going to be, if I were to bring my sins to the Lord, it would be if I would get a brand new shirt. With no stain. With no crease. With that smell of a new shirt. And then finally, there's a powerful moment on verse 12 when David asked the Lord to restore the joy of his salvation. You see, when we go to the Lord in repentance, we begin in remorse, in regret, but we leave, restore, and renew. You see, restoration is making things new. Why am I telling you this? Because some of us sometimes believe that we don't know if God can actually do this. You know, Captain, if you really know my life, you know that I have a lot of junk inside that, I don't really know if the Lord can really restore me. If you just would know my life. And I think that the reason why we think that is because we think that when we go to the Lord will not understand us. Or the Lord's going to be like, I'm just waiting for you to sin again. He's not going to do that. There's a little clip from the movie Chronicles of Narnia that I think it explained to us how some people sees God in relation to their sins.
Are you aware stealing rations is a capital offense at sea?
Quite enough of you.
Unhand the tale. The great Aslan himself gave me this tale. No one, repeat, no one touches the tale. Period, exclamation mark.
Sorry.
Now, I will have the orange, then I will have satisfaction.
Watch it.
Sorry.
Trying to run away? We're on a boat, you know.
Look, can't we just discuss this?
That was for stealing, that was for lying, and that was for good measure. That's the spirit! We have ourselves a duel! Catch! Now, come on, take your best shot. Is that it? Come on, Lauren. Come on, again, and again. That's right!
Oh no!
That's not what God is doing. God is not there trying to shame you. God is not there saying, this is your sin, this is your sin, this is your sin. You know, place yourself in the place of that boy, the shame that he went through as his sin or mistake, or because he stole something from the boat, start just crumbling down. It's like, you stole this, you stole that. Now we're going to punish you. That's not what God is doing. But sometimes we have a difficult time because we're humans. Understanding that God is not there just waiting to sneak aside. Caught you. When Isabella was little, when we were at the training school, our apartment it was narrow, but it was like three rooms, and there was a big hall that you went to the back of her room. And I remember that Isabella being very active, there was a moment where she was quiet. And was like, that's no good. Something is happening. So I remember that we went slowly, and I remember that I peeked in her room, and she was eating a cookie in the top of her bed. So I was like, that's not good. You know, we told her not to eat cookie or anything on top of her bed because the training school back then, our apartment had an issue with ants. And, you know, if we leave leftover food, ants will go. So I remember that I went and I said, Isabella, I told my wife, Isabella is eating a cookie. And I remember that we both went, you know, slowly, and then we looked and said, Isabella. And she did exactly this. She had the cookie in her mouth, and she saw us, and she moved really slow, looking at us. With her other hand, she lifted the pillow. She lowered the pillow, and she said, yes, Daddy. You see, and sometimes we do that. Yes. Is that from the Lord? It's a multimedia message. You see, and we have those two concepts of, if I bring my sins to the Lord, He's going to judge me. Or I won't bring it anything, because even though we know the Lord is looking, even though we know that the Lord knows exactly what we're thinking right now, we still think that we can hide and say, yes, Lord. But God wants to give us this experience, a full renew, a full salvation, of getting rid of all the dirt, all the sin, all the junk that we have. He's not waiting for us to just stumble, but He's waiting for us to come to Him and experience His love and His care. And it's unbelievable how, you know, we always try to hide this, even though we don't have to. There's one of the things that I love about this community is that once a year, I am a judge of a car show, and I know absolutely nothing about cars. I think I already shared that with you. I mean, you know, so I have to go there, and they give me it's a car show at the Muscle Car City, and they give me a paper, and I have to judge all these like beautiful cars from the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, and you know, it's a big responsibility. And one of the funny things about this gig is that when I go and I judge their cars, if I say to any of them, "Can I open the trunk of their car?" Their first question is, "You're not supposed to judge my trunk." Because that's where they're putting all their junk. Their car looks like impeccable. And you could put some rice and beans in the top of the hood and just eat from there. That's how clean, how shiny it is. But once you open the trunk, you see all the junk that they live outside, inside of that. And we don't have to do that. We don't have to pretend that in the outside everything is so pretty. But then when we go deeper into our heart, we know what we carry. And that's the thing. The key here is we know. We know. It makes me think of the same David in Psalms 139 when he said, "Search me, God. Know my thoughts. See if there is anything in me, anything offensive, and lead me in the way everlasting." Here's another honest prayer from David. And he's saying, if there's anything in me, Lord, that offends you, I don't want to hide anything else. But basically what David's saying here is, take this out of my life. Because if we want to experience the fullness of God's grace, then we need to open our trunk and let God get rid of the things that are holding us back. There's a great illustration from, he's a famous pastor, Francis Chang. And I think that will help us better understand this conflict that we go through in our minds in a regular basis. Alex got this water from the food pantry, and we've been getting this water. It's celebrity water. It makes me feel famous. And I'm not sure about what's the issue, or not, it's not an issue, but what's the deal with this water, but I love this water. I really do. And I know water is good for me, but here's the problem. I also like soda, but I know the soda is not really good for me, but I like it. And you see, I think this is some Christians sometimes. You know, Lord, I love you, Lord. Think for another day. Oh, I can't stand that sister. Lord, today I want to spend some more time in your word. I can look at porn in the computer. Oh, Lord, teach me your ways, Lord. I want to be able to be like some of those preachers and like quote scripture. Hey, but sometimes I have to use some cuss words. And there's this whole thing back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And maybe you were there, so I kept on. That's not me. I know. That's none of us. This is the people from the other church. Right? But, you know, you say, like, this is not us. We don't do that. We don't go back and forth like, I know my Jesus. I love him. But maybe that's fine, right? 90% Jesus, 10% sin. You see, and we keep doing this. And we pretend that's not us. You see, I hope you still have your prayer journal. You know, I keep checking on mine. And I'm doing like a check every time that I see that God answer a prayer. You know, 1, 2, 3. So for all the prayers that I have wrote, 4 of my prayers has been answered already. They were not the answers that I wanted all the time, but I want to believe that this is the God, the answers that God has for me. So I want to invite you to, hopefully you still have your prayer journal. If you don't, that's okay. I mean, you can come to the altar. But we're going to do something different today. We're going to play the words of Psalms 51. And I want you to think about this concept of, What is your understanding? Like, do you feel that you can come to the Lord and bring that to Him? Then do it. Maybe you were like this. Like, you know what's good for you, but we also enjoy what's not so good for us. Maybe we're all even mixing together because we don't think it's a big deal. It's okay. I mean, as long as the majority is God, you know, I can deal with, I can put some sin in my life. It's okay. But you see, as much as I love this water, with the soda inside, it's just not as good anymore. You see, I'm no longer experiencing the full refreshness of this water. And it's the same thing if we're mixing God and our sins together, we're no longer experiencing all that God has for us. So just like King David this morning, my challenge for you is for you to say, Lord, search me. Lord, I want to ask you for forgiveness for this and that. And that. I want to you to come and make me all new. I want to be able to not go back and forth. I want to be able to stick whatever with whatever is good. So like I said, so it's about a 2-minute reading. We're not going to have a piano playing today. This is disgusting now. Don't try this at home. So take this time, approach the Lord. If you have it, write down your prayer. This is a way for you to go in and see, okay, here's what the Lord is doing. If you don't have it, just pray in your seat, pray in the altar. But listen to the words again of Psalm 51 and see if there's anything in you that you need to bring to the Lord this morning. Right after that, we're going to have a prayer and we'll move on to our closing song. Listen to the words of Psalm 51, please.
Psalm 51, for the director of music, a psalm of David, when the prophet Nathan came to him after David had committed adultery with Bathsheba. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, so that sinners will turn back to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, you who are God my Savior, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. Open my lips, Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart you, God, will not despise. May it please you to prosper Zion, to build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in the sacrifices of the righteous, in burnt offerings offered whole. Then bulls will be offered on your altar.
Father, this is an honest prayer this morning. Do not cast us away from your presence. Father, you know what are the sins that are deep within our hearts. Father, sometimes we're ashamed. We have a hard time admitting. But Father, it's just so good to know that you're not pointing fingers at any of us. However, you rejoice that every time that we come to you and we say, Lord, forgive me because I have sinned against you, against my brother, against my sister. Father, help us not to use this as an excuse to keep on sinning. help us to understand that you want something more for us. You don't want us just to be an average person. You want us to be thriving. You want us to be flourishing. You want us to leave without the stains and carry all this baggage and all this junk in our lives. You want us to be free. So Father, be with us. Give us the courage to come before you and say, Father, forgive me. And help us to rely on your Holy Spirit to not sin again. Help us that as we come to you, spend time with you, write in our prayer journal, help us to see the difference that the Holy Spirit is making in our lives. Help us to make a decision to follow you. Father, we thank you for your love, your mercy, your compassion towards us. We can't repay that to you, Father. And you know that. But you give it to us because you are compassionate and because you are good. Help us to follow the example, Father, and do the same for others around us. And Father, help that each person here that prayed, that brought their concerns to the Lord, help us to just leave it there. Once we give it to you, Father, we know that you just take it away, but help us not to reach back and grab that sin again. Help us to leave this place free and light. Father, we love you. We thank you again for your love, your mercy, your compassion. And Father, if there's anything else in our lives that offends you, we ask you to bring to the surface so we can address it with your help. We pray all this in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, the only one that's able to remove those sins of our lives and make us new. It is your name that we pray, and God's people say, amen and amen. May God bless you.
Our closing song today is Christ is All. And I would just like to read the first verse that we're going to sing together. And it says, I bring to thee my heart to fill. I feel how weak I am, but still to thee for help I call. In joy or grief, to live or die, for earth or heaven, this is my cry, be thou my all in all. Let's sing together from verse 1 after an introduction from the piano. I bring to thee my heart to fill. I feel how weak I am, but still to thee for help I call. In joy or grief, to live or die, for earth or heaven, this is my cry, be thou my all in all. Christ is all, yes, all in all. My Christ is all in all. Christ is all, yes, all in all. My Christ is all in all. Around me in the world I see no joy that turns my soul from thee. Its honors fade and fall, but with thee through I
I mount the cross, I count again no suffer loss. For thou art all in all. Christ is all, yes, all in all. My Christ is all in all. Christ is all, yes, all in all. My Christ is all in all.
I would like to ask you to read with me verse 3, and we're going to sing verse 4 to finish. I've little strength to call my own, and what I've done before thy throne, I here confess is small, but on thy strength, O God, I lean, and through the blood that makes me clean, thou art my all in all.
No tempest can my courage shake, my love from thee no pain can take, no fear my heart abhor. And where I cannot see, I'll trust, for then I know no surely must be still my own. Yes, all in all, my Christ is all in all. Christ is all, yes, all in all, my Christ is all in all. Our
benediction taking place from Book of Romans, chapter 15, verse 13, say, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. May we go in peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
I chased you into the light. Yeah, I stayed there to see myself pure. All the ashes and scars, they fail.